Hallelujah.
Just come on in and be blessed by the move of the Holy Spirit today. Be blessed by the word that will come forth this morning. So let us go now before the throne and pray this morning as we enter into his presence, oh God. This morning, God, we do give you thanks. We do give you glory. We do give you honor. Because it's all about you, Lord God. It's never been about us. It's all about you being served. It's all about us living for you, Lord God.
Yes, Lord.
It's all about you being seen in our lives, Lord God.
Thank you, God.
We can take no credit for anything, Lord God. So this morning, as we enter into that place of thanksgiving, that you will be praying, we come to say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
We come to say praise your holy name.
Praise
your
holy name.
Yes. And we lift up your holy name, and you are a holy God.
Holy God.
And you are everlasting, everlasting, Lord.
Yes,
there is none like you, Lord.
None like you, God.
And so therefore this morning, may you be magnified.
Yes,
may you
God.
Be glorified.
Yes, yes.
Our praise this morning, God.
Hallelujah.
Because we come to praise you. We
yes,
come for a show, Lord God.
Yes,
we come to
God.
The name of Jesus.
Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes, God.
To eat at your table and then take the food and go back out, oh God, and share it with others, God.
Yes,
that they will not be so full that no one will be receiving from them, God. So let us, oh God, be a house for you.
Yes,
that
Lord.
Others will eat from your table.
Yes,
as
God.
We eat from them, that we will go out and share with others, Almighty God.
Yes,
so
Lord.
As we turn this service over to you, Lord God,
yes,
not
Jesus.
To your people, but over to you, God, that the word will go forth and the lives shall be changed. And as we come together collectively to worship you, may you be praised in Jesus' name.
Jesus'
name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Oh, praise the name of God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
He's worthy.
Yes, glory.
Thank you. Good morning. Good morning. And God bless you, the Dominion Outreach Worship Center, this morning. God is worthy to be praised. God is worthy to be praised.
Hallelujah.
Get to start again. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise God for the beginning of the workshop that happened over the weekend. Great teaching. Amen.
Amen.
It was great teaching, and we thank God for it. I'm ready to worship. Y'all ready to praise God?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Would you just declare, Lord, you're mighty?
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Yes, he is. Hallelujah.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
I give myself away. So you don't. For the rest of this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, try that with dominion. Praise him. Some of you at home didn't open your mouth yet that are watching. Those of you that are catching this on the replay, give the Lord a great dominion praise right there.
Hallelujah.
Glory to the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Anybody believe that word with me, that the name of the Lord is a strong tower and the righteous run in and they are safe? Anybody feel safe this morning? I'm telling you, when gas prices still tend to increase, you're still safe. Groceries continue to go up, but you're still safe. New strands of a virus coming out, but you're still safe. More bill at the end of the month than you got money, don't even worry about it. God can wipe out debt. Would you let somebody tell them I'm still safe? Tell them I'm still safe. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I don't know about y'all, but I believe that word. I keep on saying it time after time after time again. It is better to be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. Amen, somebody? I'm thankful that God allows me to be in his house. You may the day, you know the day may come where we may not be able to gather like this. We may have to go back to the Book of Acts church where we gather in homes throughout the week and utilize the internet to pull ourselves together and to worship the Lord. And we may have to have text message codes that we go underground and begin to worship the Lord. Can you still be saved and be a Christian when them days come and still honor the living God when them times come? Amen, somebody. Amen. Just as long as we get a chance to get together for koinonia and fellowship with each other. Forsake not the assembly of ourselves together. Amen, somebody. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise. Sister Erica, come on and take us through a new housekeeping things. Amen, amen, and amen.
Yes, ma'am.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We are heading into the month of July.
great anticipation and look forward to a fresh wind and fire of the Lord's presence to begin to visit us each time we gather. As we approach the month of July, we want to remind you this is not a time to give out, to give in, or give up. God is in need of your availability, your flexibility, and more importantly, your accountability. To and for His kingdom to come and His will be done in our lives. Let's keep our focus and remember God is focused on working in, for, and allowing the kingdom of God to work through us. As we suggest, we have to put that work in if we want to make the see the kingdom made manifest in our lives. I just ask that if you have not caught any of the sermons that Bishop has preached this month or any of the Bible studies, I ask you to go back to YouTube or go through your Facebook reel and just listen up to them again. This pastor has really, Bishop has really placed on our lives that God needs us.
Amen.
And any day you watch the news and the things that are going on, if it's not evident that we as Christians need to stand up and stand out and continue to work for the kingdom and let the devil know this foolishness will no longer continue. He needs us to be able to stand in the kingdom, and He needs us to be able to, have endurance. And to do that, we have to have healthy bodies.
That's right.
Our annual theme scripture is still Matthew 6:33. I ask that we read it together. But seek first
the kingdom of God and His righteousness,
and all these things shall be added to you.
That's not what it says. Our theme, we believe this month has been that God has need of us on Sunday and on Wednesdays, and we are in need of God. So let's look forward to the fresh fire of this month of July. If we have any first-time visitors, if you could please raise your hand. Looks like we are all in the house this morning. Amen. However, if you are visiting us online, we just ask that you leave us your name and where you're from. And on behalf of Bishop and First Lady, we want to welcome you to the Walk of Dominion here at Dominion Outreach Center, Worship Center. I ask that you would go ahead and prepare your tithe and offering while I read a few announcements. Monday's meal. Joining Bishop for Monday's meal on Monday night at 8 p.m. It's manna to help you move your life, to help you move to your life's mandate. This week's episode concludes the sentence of the work in the house in aligning our houses with God. So tune in and tag a friend at 8 p.m. on Monday. Tilt Tuesday. Tune in with Lady for Tilt Tuesday for the month of July as she prepares for a new theme concerning consecration.
Amen.
We want to encourage you to fast, pray, and seek the Lord's face as we prepare for glory. Amen?
Amen.
Next Tuesday morning at 6 a.m. Wednesday night, join Bishop on first and third Wednesdays in July as we seek His presence for fresh fire to fall in our summer sizzle. There are moments when you have to fight fire with fresh fire. Amen?
Amen.
July begins with a celebration of new life. Join us next Sunday, July 7th, for baptism and communion.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, saints.
It's wonderful when we continue to add to the kingdom.
Amen.
It's a refreshing wind that's about to blow, and we look to stay in the flow. Baptism candidates are sure to communicate names to your coordinator. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Visitors, if you haven't found a faith family, we want to encourage you to connect with us here in the Walk of Dominion at Dominion Outreach Worship Center. Join us this third Sunday, July, which is the 21st. Our pastor will meet you after service in the conference room, where he will spend time helping you understand our why through our vision, mission, and values. in the short sign up after service. You can go to dow.church to register or see Sister Sheila or myself. Visitors plan your Sunday, calling all of the Walk of Dominion to join us in our plan. Your Sunday campaign from now to back to church Sunday in September. We want to invite our community, neighbors, and friends to let us know when they plan to visit us on any Sunday from now until then. So don't wait until the week before we do the service to start inviting people. Start inviting people now. Send out the dates so that we can fill the house. Amen.
Amen.
All right. On the screen behind me is our new flyer with links to our website for anyone to plan their visit on which Sunday they can come so that we can prepare to serve them and be a blessing. So let's look forward to giveaways, groceries, and gas cards, but more importantly, the Lord's grace in our lives as we walk into dominion until Jesus comes. If you haven't downloaded the flyer, please do so today by visiting the website at www.church to share with and invite us.
Amen.
So can we all commit to doing that this week on the website, download it,
with
our friends and family. If you're interested in connecting with our Walk of Dominion, your Dominion Outreach Center, we do have our Kingdom Dominionaires class, which is each fourth Saturday at 10 a.m. right here in the chapel. And if you're interested in connecting, please send me after service. Follow us on social media. We do have a fan page, which is Dominion Ministries. Our group page, which is Walk of Dominion. Follow us on Twitter at DominionMIN and Instagram at Dominion Economics. You can subscribe to the weekly church newsletter that comes from admin at dow.church, so please spam this on your email. Bishop, do you have anything?
Yes, I do.
Good morning.
Good
morning again.
Good morning.
2 days, actually. One, I'm looking for willing workers to work with our children. I really want our children's ministry to excel. And I want them to have their own academy. So I'm looking for some willing workers that God has prompted your heart to teach or to just share with the children. I'm looking for some willing workers. Please see me right after service. Number two, worship team is always open. Amen. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Three, women's fellowship. Women, I believe that God has some very unique gifts on the inside of you. And I believe it is more effective for us to be together than to just have virtual Bible studies. And I want us to fellowship one with another. So on the second Saturday, that is July the 13th. July 13th. I want us to fellowship together on July the 13th. We're going to start our Bible studies. Erica is going to be teaching, Sister Anita is going to be teaching. It's something that we've created ourselves, not out of a book, so we're not charging you to buy a book or anything like that. But not only do we want to study, we want to fellowship, and we want to grow together. We're stronger and better together. So make plans on the second Saturday of this month to get our women's fellowship restarted. Kicked off, however you want to say it, and for the children. I plan to have something for the children, so we have to bring children along with us. I'm probably going to solicit my daughter and maybe someone else to come and do activities for the children while the women are meeting. Amen?
Amen.
Reach out to fellowship. Let's fellowship together. Amen?
Amen.
Time on the second Saturday will be 11 a.m. you use Cash App at $ DollarSign, or you can download the GiveAfly app and look for Dominion Outreach Worship Center. I'll ask that you stand at this time. And repeat after me. As I give my tithe and offering.
As I give my tithe and offering.
Cheerfully.
Cheerfully.
I believe in God for it.
I believe in God for it.
Checks in the mail.
Checks in the mail.
Gifts and surprises.
Gifts and surprises.
Bills to decrease.
Bills to decrease.
Bills paid off.
Bills paid off.
Blessings and increase.
Blessings and increase.
I believe the word of the Lord.
I believe the word of the Lord.
Do you really?
Yes, I do. Amen.
I say this like we believe the word of the Lord.
I believe the word of the Lord.
The Bible says.
The Bible says.
Luke 6:38.
Let's read together. Give, and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full. Press down, shake it together to make room for more. Running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you get back.
I am a giver.
And
do you know why it runs over and pours into our lap?
Okay,
come on,
say something.
All right, that's excess.
Amen. Hallelujah.
That's
right.
Amen.
All right.
So are we givers?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
All right.
I declare
in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
That debt and lack.
That debt and lack.
Are here and now.
Dissolved.
And done away with. Forever in my life.
And in the walk of dominion.
God ordained ministry worldwide.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Dear God, Lord, we praise you, God.
Yes, we do. Hallelujah.
And just lift up your holy and righteous name.
Yes, Lord.
Bless us abundantly.
Yes, Lord, thank you, Lord, again, God.
And you only ask us to give a small portion of that back to you, God.
Yes, God.
So today we give that back to you, God.
Yes, God.
Let us continue to be a blessing to those that we can, Lord Jesus. Lord and God, if we don't have it to give right now, God, we know that you will give us another opportunity to do so, God.
Yes,
not because we deserve it, but simply because you love us, God.
Yes, love us, God.
Lord, we honor you, Lord. We praise your holy and righteous name.
Father, Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, God. Praise the Lord. Glory to the name of God.
Oh God, we worship you.
Glory to your name, oh God.
I thank God because offering and giving our tithes and offerings is a form of worship. Amen?
Yes.
It's a form of worship. We honor God when we give him our first.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord God. There's a blessing attached to it.
All of my worship, you, Lord.
Sacrifices all across the altar. Elijah just washed them. And then after he had poured water on the water trough of the altar, Elijah said, so that they will know that I serve the living God. Let the real God who is alive in heaven, let him who is God answer a fire. The Bible says that fire came from heaven and consumed the entire altar, consumed all of the water, burned up all of the stones. I believe that's the kind of fire we need today's time. Amen, somebody? Come, can somebody give the Lord a great dominion praise right there? Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. We got work to do. Come on, tell them we got work to do. Come on, tell them we got work to do. Let's look at this very verse on the screen behind me. The book of John chapter 9 verse 4. John chapter 9 verse 4. Let's read it together. Should be on the screen on 3. 1, 2, 3. I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Go ahead.
The night is coming when no one can work. Do
y'all really believe that that is the truth? The night is coming when no man can work. Come on, let's do it again on 3, 1, 2, 3. I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Go ahead. I believe that sometimes we don't see that God wants done in the earth is because there are people doing the work that God didn't send. I want you to look carefully at the verse. Jesus said, I must work the works of him who sent me. You can't do a work for God unless God sends you. Come
That's
on,
right.
Can you say amen?
Right.
Amen? And you got to put that work in. Somebody say, put the work in.
Put the work in.
You got to put that work in while it is day. For the night is coming when no man can work. I'm excited about this kind of work because I thoroughly believe that it is going to be light in Goshen where the kingdom is,
yes,
and darkness in Egypt where the world,
yes,
is.
Sir.
Amen, somebody? I mean, metaphorically, while the world is on its way experiencing the trials of the tribulation period, God is going to keep those who are connected with him, serve him, and honestly give their lives to him in a real way. going to make sure that every need is met. Amen, somebody? Amen. Y'all may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Come on, brothers, and move this podium out of the way. I want to spend some time just kind of talking with you a little bit this morning. Like that, wonderful. Amen. Before I even get into all of that, let's these put them on the table for me as well. All of those and the other books as well. Amen. While he is doing that, let me see. I think I saw him. I was talking to my father just about this young man just yesterday. I said, you know the young man that just stands, and he stands in the hallway and does security work for us, and stands in the hallway and sings, can't sing a lick, but he sounds like a man when he sings.
That's right.
I mean, he sounds like a man when he sings. Walk like a man, talk like a man. It's important that men and others see men praising and worshiping God. Uh-huh. He serves God with all of his heart and gives all of his effort and energy and time before the Lord. He doesn't know that I'm giving him this his certificate this morning. As I present these, I would that we would make sure that we give honor and reverence to these men, because the times that we are in are uncertain. Somebody say uncertain. But the certainty is that God never leaves us without a moment of protection. So brothers here at the church have completed the active shooter training for church security here at our church. So if anybody comes in here and thinks that they want to try something, they're going to have another thing coming. Amen, somebody? Come on, give the Lord a great praise.
Yeah.
I've just totally, Deacon Steele reminded me that they had all finished the training. I asked them to go through. And so first up, let me say this as I give these out this morning. If there is an event that happens, we'll do some training around here as a church that will take place. But would you make sure that if these men give directives and orders of what we're supposed to do, in the event that something around here happens, can we all follow instructions? Would you look at somebody and say, just follow instructions? They've gone through the training, they know what is necessary, and they are in the house to help keep us protected. Amen? Even I am going to make sure that I follow exactly what they say, because they will help preserve my life. Amen, somebody? Come on, can you receive our worshiper that came in, and that the person of Gregory Perkins? He has already completed the training. Can we make sure that we do exactly what he said? It's time to do what he says. Amen, somebody? Love you, man. Thank you for doing it. Thank you for making sure that we'll be protected here in the house. Amen, somebody?
Amen.
Praise God. Come on, baby, doing pictures. Come on, bro. Come on back. Amen.
Amen.
All right, the next brother we need to make sure that we spend some time listening to is, I call this my main man right here, Brother Wendell Cardell. Come on, let's receive him this morning.
Amen.
Let's make sure, he even walked like he done it, like he ran over. Thank you, man. Let's make sure we do what these men say. Amen.
Amen.
Why we gotta kneel down, and why we gotta duck, and why I don't wanna hear none of that. I just wanna just follow what they ask us to do. Is that all right?
Amen.
And come on, the last man here, definitely not the least man, a strong man the Lord has given us, one of the sons of this ministry, Eugene Finner. Come we praise God for them. Educated to the Maryland area and will launch soon, as he and his wife confirmed. Now listen, I want us to make sure we do what these men say, okay? All right? Praise God. Come on, they forgot the picture, man. They don't do pictures, man. He's a real man's man. Men don't do pictures like that. We all understand and stuff. I get it. I understand it. Just simply because I'm maybe old-fashioned in the sense that I know that we have ladies here who can be involved in security, Sister Erica. And I know that they can handle their own business and that sort of thing. But I'd like for the men to secure the house. Is that all right?
Amen. Go ahead, sir.
I'd like for the men to secure the house. And I'd like for the fragrance to be greeters as a part of the house. Amen, somebody?
Amen.
I don't want frowning faces on the door per se. I like for the fresh fragrance of the house, which is all of our ladies here of the Walk of Dominion, to actually say, welcome, God bless you, come on in, we're glad you're here this morning, and smile, and do all of that. But I want the men to have the kind of face that says, try it if you want to.
Try
it. Yeah. And I know we've got some out here that are like that, that says, try it as you want to. I know we got some ladies like that, and I want some concessions for Sister Cheryl and also Sister Erica, because they some try it if you want to, ladies, and all that kind of stuff. So I get it, I understand. And I have enough. She got her hand raised up way again. No, sir, not right now, no. And some other ladies. And I have a couple other certificates for some other people. I want to spend a few minutes talking to you a little bit about churchwide leadership training and the Dark Collective real quickly. Simply because, of course, as you already know, when I start to sit down, it'll be a Q&A kind of Sunday. And so, Sister Erica and Brother Mike Steele, if you have questions, go ahead and start passing out those cards now with pens. No question is too much or none too little. And make sure that once you finish, raise your hand. They'll come back, cards up from you, and bring them to Lady, and she will get them to me. Amen, somebody? And we've been engaging in this series that is called The Dark Collective. I want you to take a few minutes and take a look at this very first video. Just make sure that laptop is connected to the ladies' phone. Make sure that there's internet on there and connected in that way. Here's what I want to mention to you to go back. Go back. Somebody say, go back.
Go back.
I want you to go back to the very first preaching that I did this past Wednesday night on YouTube, on our Facebook page, and I want you to rewatch again and engage again so that you will be able to be tracking with us. Y'all let me know when you are there for that video and I will stop talking. Amen. And make sure that she's connected in that way. While they're getting it prepared, well, I actually want them to see first. Go ahead over one more screen. Go ahead over one more screen. And that's the video we want to play right there. And we need to make sure that the laptop is connected to her phone. It's ready. Wonderful. Go ahead over and play.
Introducing the Dark Collective, extending Christian discipleship through the arts and technology. The Dark Collective offers a unique online training program taught across 6 courses. You will learn about thriving churches' foundational theology, its vision and identity, and the original call given to the community. You will also learn about the practices that guide both leadership and laity toward congregational efficacy, the giftings of the body, and the inreach and outreach activities, all that strengthen a congregational ministry while attracting youth and the uncommitted, will also be examined. The goal of these courses is to help congregations understand their identity and better engage with the people in their communities. These 6 pathways build upon one another to provide a complete, fully online experience for congregational groups meeting to dig in and map out practical applications for a thriving congregation. Join other congregations who are thriving as a part of the Dark Collective by visiting thedarkcollective.org. Welcome to the Dark Collective.
Amen. Come on, give the Lord a praise for that right there.
Amen.
We've got to be in a place where we look at doing church differently so that we can be a part of discipling our culture. How many of you ever been somewhere and when you see somebody sitting still, normally you see them in a posture where their head is down and it's rolling through. This becomes the means and mechanism as we're streaming on platforms this morning, whereby which we are discipling people and helping them understand how to think theologically and understanding who God is. And so utilizing both the arts and utilizing technology is going to be a way to do that. Now, as a part of the Doc Collective series, there are about 6 different modules in terms of booklets that are a part of this. I'm using this as I'm taking the leadership of the Church of God in Christ Second Jurisdiction through as a part of the certificate program at Hampton University. And what the dean has allowed me to do is to have hours for free. And I'm going to slow walk. Somebody say slow walk. I'm going to slow walk us as a church in regards to this. And so I've got one more video that is up there. You may need to minimize the screen. And then there's a video right underneath that that is on the Dark Collective website. I want you to see that one because how many of you watched the first training that I did on what is theology? Right, 1, 2, come on, by show of hands. 1, 2, 3, right. So the rest of you, I need you to go back and I need you to catch it on Dominion on Demand. Somebody say Dominion on Demand.
Dominion on Demand.
Or go to Dominion Ministries Facebook page. Say Dominion Ministries Facebook page.
Dominion
or the Walk of Dominion group page. Somebody say Walk of Dominion group page. I want you to go back and I want you to watch the first lesson and the first training that I did because I want you to be able to track well with me so that you're able to see that. Come on, I'm going to give some help real quickly and help with the next video so that we're able to see that one. Go ahead on there. All right, let's go ahead on there, but it's not showing. Interested in walking through this. All right, come on real quickly, come to me real quickly and I'm going to give you yours now. If you're interested in walking through this, come on real quickly, right on from the back to the front, and I'm going to make sure you get one so that you'll have it and that you'll have those on these for me first questions. All right, wonderful. Come on real quick, real fast, real quick, real fast, and I will make sure that you have got one. Amen. Together as a church, and go ahead on Mary back to the PowerPoint, and I want to show how the manuals and things work. If you need one, all right, let's make sure everybody that wants one has one. All right, I think we're good. Okay, all right, let's make sure everybody that needs one has one. All right, I look like they're gonna run out. Okay, that's good. Let's make sure we have those that are out. So, for the homework, let's make sure the PowerPoint is back up out here and put it on duplicate screen. There we go. So in your foundations book, go ahead inside your packet and pull out your foundations book. That is the blue book. The blue book. Foundations blue book. The family will say, reflect and renew our system of faith and belief. Yeah, that's what it will say. Pull that one out. And the homework for your foundations book is I want you to read pages 1 through 29. And inside of this, what will happen is there will be different places where you will be able to write down your thoughts as a part of a devotional study inside of the foundations book, right? Now the Bible says, without the foundation, how can the righteous live? If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do, is what the scripture says. So we're going back to, how does theology fit? I think the example I gave in the teaching was that, now I'm not here to put anybody on the spot, but one of the ways for me, I'll use me as an example, one of the reasons why I do not participate in the lottery system is because it's a form of gambling, and it communicates my lack of trust in God that comes from my theological worldview, right? And so helping you develop a theological worldview from a biblical and scriptural perspective is critically important. And then what I want you to do is, now you should have another book that I did not give you quite yet. I need a little help up here. Somebody come and help pass out the Navigating the Call book. So the Navigating the Call books, let's just pass these out to everybody that would need one. Navigating the Call book is this book here, and you can give this one to somebody. Pages 10 through 11 in Navigating the Call. So both the series and Navigating the Call book goes together. Now, we're only going to do this on Fourth Wednesday. Somebody say Fourth Wednesday.
Fourth Wednesday.
We're only going to do it on Fourth Wednesday. And the next time we'll gather together again will be on July the 24th. If somebody else needs a packet, I got one more packet up here left. One more up here left. Somebody can have. Thank you, sir. No, for July the 24th. We're going to do it on Fourth Wednesday. And we're going to slow walk our way through. Let's make sure Mary has a Navigating the Call book. You're going to read pages 10 through 11. She needs one up here. I'm Navigating the Call book, pages 10 through 11. And we're going to take our time as a church, and we're going to walk through this and redevelop our foundation, and as a church body together, and not just the executive leadership team, we're going to work through a strategic plan as a church. Is that all right?
Amen.
And so we're going to begin with theology, and we're going to do it that way as we get started. Having said that, I want to just kind of jump in a little bit to Q&A Sunday for today. And I want to review June's word and reminding us with the understanding that God needs us and we need God. How many of y'all believe that? That God needs us and we need God. God needs us at YMCA. He needs us at the gym, the grocery store, the food line, the movie theater. Come on, talk to me. God needs us in every sector of society. And then we also need God. And the place that we need God the most is that we need God in our local houses. Amen, somebody?
Amen.
And so I want to go to this very, very first screen under Kingdom Work here that says, we have focused this month on the work to be done in the kingdom of God. And as we experience the state of affairs, I love how the Holy Spirit does things when He gives me things to say and to do. Because I had no idea that Sister Erica would go the way that she went, but she's right in line with our concepts for today. As we experience the state of affairs in our culture, it's important that Christians look to be the light. Amen, somebody? It is important for us to look to be the light in our state of affairs in the world in which we're in. And we should not just turn this world over to the enemy. Jesus, when He gave His life for us, He did not just bring salvation to us as human beings, but He brought salvation to the created order. Somebody say the created order. That means the entire universe, all of the cosmological evidence of the existence of God throughout all life. He reconciled all of that back to Himself. And what Satan does is operates in deception and trying to find a way to keep us from being connected with the living God. And look at this one, should be on the screen behind me. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 14 says these words, "You are the light of the world." Somebody say, "I am the light." You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Now you gotta understand that this is written in the Greco-Roman time period of the New Testament, and the way that they established houses of importance of governing leaders. The term church is a Greek word that means ecclesia, called out ones as representatives. Those who were governing leaders had houses on hills that could be seen from all around the city. Okay, Reverend, what is the point? God expects for us to be like a governing house on the hill, that everybody should be able to see our good works and then speak highly of the God that we serve. Can you say amen? So God wants your life to actually become a mirror image of Him, and He wants to light us up. Somebody say, light us up. So that people can see us. Let's go to that next screen. One of the most difficult places to be the light is in our immediate spheres of influence. The place of our families, our homes, and our extended families. It's tough to be the light at home. You can be a light here at church, because don't nobody really know you like that. That they know what they see on Sundays. Because you know, we become a Sunday culture kind of church now. And I'm looking forward to the days of Wednesday night in-person service and Friday night fire prayer meetings. We are again. I'm looking forward to those days returning back to the church. But people know what they see, and people in your extended family and at home know the real you. God wants you to be the real you at home first. And so when you look at these messages we did this month, let's go to that next screen. On June 2nd in Mark chapter 3, verse 13, we did a message called "I Got Work to Do." And that was responding to the call of God for the kingdom, being able to hear Jesus call me to Him, not so much just to be with Him. See, one of the issues in the church age today, what I would dare say probably over the last 40 years or 50 years or so, is that when we utilize the passage in 2 Corinthians about come out from the world and be ye separate, right? And so we've had this isolationist mentality of coming out from the world, but according to Mark chapter 16, just jot that down as a reference point, Mark chapter 16, and then ride through verses 16 through 19. One of the first things that Jesus told his disciples to do after he resurrected them and then was ascended into heaven, before he did that, he said to his disciples, "Go ye into all the world." So we've had a conflicting message over the last, I would say, 100 years to maybe 150 years of coming out of the world. Now, don't get me wrong, sanctification is necessary. Now, look at it, I got 5 minutes. Come on, brother. Nobody here but me and the two mothers in the church. Come on, I'm saved, sanctified, fire baptized, filled with the Holy Ghost. Come on, what am I having to start with people at? And running for Jesus or running for my life, right? All of that is necessary, but that is sanctification after you have come out of the world. God has never intended for us to detach ourselves away from the world and become exclusionary and isolated. What His intention was for the world not to be in us as we are in the world. You got to be able to preach and with your lifestyle so something they can see you in the break room and see what's going on your social media thread.
Right.
That's how you preach in today's time. You preach by getting to work on time, doing a good job, being thorough, making sure that you are a good steward with the organization's resources. You preach at the family reunion when everybody else got 5 on it, and then they put all of theirs out when you come around and when you're in the environment and they have 6 packs and 24 packs. You have your lemonade and juice and water, and you are able to be in the environment and not influenced by them, but yet influence them because you don't drink and get down like they do anymore. Uh-huh. Come on, say amen if you can. So tell somebody, I got work to do. On June 9th, Mark chapter 3, verses 20 through 27, we talked about housework, right? Housework and the work that we do in our houses. And I made the statement, the hardest thing you will ever do is align your house with God. Because in our houses, now we love Jesus with all our heart, at least we espouse and say that we do. But the greatest commandment Jesus said is you would love your neighbor as yourself. Okay, you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your strength, and then love your neighbor as yourself. Well, loving the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength first begins at home. Amen. And the reality is that we spend more time nuancing at home with shades of gray in our decision making rather than what's black and what's white. Say amen if you can.
Amen.
I ain't gonna push you too hard today. I just want to say we gotta let the house work. Tell somebody you gotta put some work in at home. Yeah, then on June 16th, we had a nice Father's Day message of protecting the house. Come on, look at a brother and say, why don't you protect this house? Yeah, the atmosphere of the physical house of God, but more importantly, your body as a temple of the Holy Spirit. You've got to protect the house that you encase the Holy Spirit in so that really the Holy Spirit is protecting you more than you protecting him. Yeah, he's working to help keep you protected if you listen to wisdom and instruction. And that had to do with leadership and legacy and listening to the voice of God and listening to the next generation and paying attention to their cues in terms of where they are so that you can protect them from what's coming in the culture of our world. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Oh, somebody, we got work to do. Then June the 23rd, John chapter 9, 13 through 25, we dealt with the Pharisees. And that message was called the Religious Rules, Rites, and Religion. And there is some stuff that's got in God's house that we got to get out of God's house so that the house can do its work. I'm going to say that one more again. There's some stuff that has gotten in God's house. If you just pay attention to a little bit of your newsreels and your feed, you're seeing what's going on in the world around us. Would you look at somebody and just gently and lightly say to them, why don't you mind your business? Come on, say, mind your business and let God clean his own house. I feel a hook of the Mashundai right through there. We got to learn how to mind our own business and let God clean his own house. In other words, while God is cleaning the house, practice keeping your mouth awful.
That's right.
I'm just trying to help you. Because God is determined that he is returning for a church without spot or wrinkle. That means a level of maturity to where we have come out of the world. And as Paul would say to the Corinthian church, there are certain things that shouldn't even be named among you as Christians and as believers. Now, that doesn't mean you're going to get every I dotted and every T right, but it does mean you're going to live a repentant lifestyle. Somebody ought to write that down and put it in your notes right there. I must live a repentant lifestyle. If you ever get to the place where you can't hear the Holy Ghost talking to you about your decision making and your wrongdoing, you may want to check your salvation card to see if you're really connected with the Lord like that. And if you have gone reprobate to where you just turn away from the things of God, you might want to check and see if your name is still written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Because those of us who are connected to the Lord, the last thing we want to do is we don't want to offend the Lord or to offend the Holy Ghost. I don't know about y'all, but I need him and I need them in my life every day. Shoot, I need the Holy Ghost just to sit at the stoplight when the contact high is coming by to just help keep me straight. Come on, somebody say, I know that's right. You need the Holy Ghost every single day. So this month, God talked to us about the work in his house, let him work in his house, working in us, and allowing the house of God to do its work. Now, let me come back to that for about 10, 15 seconds here, and then we'll start to get to some of these questions and answer for Q&A Sunday. Let me come back to that just for a moment. Now check this out with me. I want you to understand that the house of God has work to do in and of itself. Now watch what I'm getting ready to say. Without you necessarily having to fabricate the work. The house of God. It's kind of like what Big Girl did this morning in terms of taking us back to that old school song. She said, we forget what it took for us to get to where we were in the generation that has gone before us. That's associated with what I mean in terms of the house of God. Now let me make the application plain. So you walk in to the house of God with cancer in your body, without anybody having to lay hands on you, because it is the house of God and the atmosphere is full of the presence of God, you can get healed in the midst of the worship service and don't nobody even know it. Because the house of God is doing its job in terms of its work. The Bible says that when they finished building the temple of Solomon, when they finished putting it together in terms of David's financing and all the work was done, the Bible says when it was completed that the glory of the Lord filled the temple like an essence of smoke in the environment. I'm losing the language to communicate what this glory is. But the Bible says that the weight, the kabod of the glory of God was so heavy that the pillars in the house began to shake. God wants to flood the environment of his houses of worship to with his presence. I feel the Holy Ghost now. To where demons start shrieking and running out of the lives of people in fear and terror because of the living God. I got Bible for it. Let me qualify it for you. When Israel was brought out of Egypt, right around Exodus 15, between chapter 13 and chapter 15, you ain't got to turn there. I'm going to paraphrase for you what it says. It says that when they came out to the mountain to worship, God gave Moses instruction. He said, tell the people to wash their clothes, wash themselves, purify themselves. Tell the men of Israel to stay away from their wives as I come to visit them. On the very first day when the mountain shook, I'm talking about Sinai, with the glory of God, the reverence of God among Israel was so strong that just on the first day, the elders of Israel came to Moses and said, look here, you go up in the mountain and talk to God. And then you come back to us and tell us what he said. Because I ain't trying to, the Bible is clear where the Lord says, I am the Lord your God. I am holy, therefore you be holy. Come on, say amen if you can. And I believe that there is a reverence that is necessary among us in terms of our posture for how we walk in relationship with God so that the house of God can do its work. Can you say amen? I'm looking forward to the day where there's no preaching and we can't even sing because the glory is so strong in the house. And I'm looking forward to the day when cancers are healed and lupus is healed and blood disorders are healed. I'm looking forward to the day where demonic principalities and powers are cast out of the lives of God's people and people are free in the psychosis of their soul because of the presence of God. I just want to give you a quick demonstration real quickly. The mothers, y'all remember this when they would call us to the altar. Remember we was getting the Holy Ghost back then and they was patting us up on the chin. Come on. Say his name, Jesus. And patting us on the back, rocking back and forth. But you know, we used to make fun of that kind of stuff back then. But after about 15 to 20 minutes of that, something would happen in the atmosphere. And all of a sudden, hidden demonic ideologies that were inside of people started manifesting and coming out of people. I'm telling you, the days are coming back where God's going to set his people free so they don't have to walk under demonic oppression and the control of Satan and how they process and live their lives each and every day. Come on, say amen if you can. Amen. All right. Let's get to some of these Q&A questions. Y'all make their way up to Sister Nita. You got to take Lady's place as she just stepped out for a moment. So bring the car, Sister Nita. She's giving to me. Here's the first question. Will you stress the importance? Oh, they're going to tell me. Somebody's going to tell me what to do. Okay. All right. Will you stress the importance again about male authority from God, Christ, man, woman, see order must be restored. Oh yeah, okay. So this is a good question. So just talking about the order of family dynamics, why this is important. Oh, this is going to be really, really good. I'm just getting excited even before I answer. Okay, y'all give me 15 seconds to just shout out by myself.
Go ahead, sir.
All right. See, Satan's plan, or I should say the process of his plan, is it does not change. The nuancing of it may change, but the processing of his plan does not change. Satan usurped. He's a usurper. Write that down. He's a usurper, is another word. He is an anarchist, is another word. He is rebellious by nature. He can never be saved and come back to the Lord. So when God gives Adam the commandment in the garden, it is so that Adam would lead his household and family properly in relationship with God to maintain alignment. Because literally, in Genesis chapter 1 and 2, what God is doing in the establishment of humanity is he is establishing the domain of heaven on earth through mankind. You should write down what I just said. God, in the book of Genesis, is establishing the domain of heaven on earth through mankind. Let me come to New Testament and I'll come back. When Jesus taught his disciples to pray, he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven."
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done where?
On earth.
On earth as it is in heaven. There's no poverty on earth in heaven, is it? There's no sickness in heaven, is it? There's no anarchy, rebellion in heaven, is it? So what Jesus said to his disciples, y'all marvel about Satan, but I saw him fall from heaven like lightning. We kind of have a misunderstanding about the fallen angels coming out of heaven like there was some great big war. There was no war. God was like, if you can't flow my way, pick an exit door. Just pick one. Because God doesn't do anarchy and doesn't do rebellion. Now, Satan understands this. So what he does is, he will, let me contemporize and make it real practical. Satan will never fight you straight up. Because he knows you are created in the image of God and in his likeness. And you carry a measure of God's authority in your personhood. This is pre-Jesus I'm talking about. When you got Jesus, you carry a greater level of measure of his authority. Okay? So Satan never going to attack you straight up. He is always going to do what he has done in the garden. So he will approach the one that does not have the authority first. And he will cause that one to see what he sees. Just check out the scripture. When the woman eats of the fruit, she eats of the fruit because the serpent says to her, "Isn't this good for food? Isn't this pleasing to the eyes? Isn't this good to make one wise?" If you ever, now ladies, don't get upset with me. Don't take off your shoes and earrings and all of that. Be very fine, okay? But if you ever want to have a woman get into something, tell her what she can't do. Because you know how y'all are. Now, you ain't going to tell me what I ain't going to do, what I can't do. Right? So this, what Satan does is he presses on that emotion of you feeling like you're being kept out of something. That's what he does. That's a manipulation tactic. and he works on your emotions. So, inside of a home dynamic, men, listen to me. I just said this to the brothers 2 or 3 weeks ago. I'm so glad this question came first. I said to them, I said, you are responsible for what happens and what does not happen in your home environment.
That's right.
When God gets ready to check on, all of us men know, in the wee hours of the morning, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 a.m., when stuff is going awry, God says, come in. Let me talk to you. What did you allow in here? A lot of times, men who have not been trained do exactly what Adam did. Look at the life that you gave me. God's saying is, well, who did I put in charge? All right, now, ladies, lean in. Come on, lean in, lean in, lean in. You got to allow him to be in charge. If he is going to handle the responsibility, don't lean back. Lean back in. Lean back in. If he's going to handle the responsibility, responding to the ability that God has given him, you have to allow him final say on 3 areas. This is so good. We go home after this. 3 areas. Spirituality.
Amen.
Morality.
Amen.
Spirituality. Morality. And the 2 are tied to the last one. Now all the ladies about to clutch their pearls right now. They all clutch their pearls. And what you do with the money. Everybody just pray. Just come on, practice with me one more time. Because if you want God in the equation of the home and family dynamic, you got to get in order. God cannot help you if you don't get in order. Because he's only trying to check with who he put in charge. Okay, let's do Bible. Alright, so in Bible, when Israel is being led by Moses, the singular leader, Jethro comes in and says, look, man, this weight is too much for you. Establish leaders of tribes, of tens, of fifties, of hundreds, right? And so, and when God gets ready to talk to Israel, he says to Moses, oh, I'm in Numbers, I think chapter 20, you come here to me and go get all of the elders of Israel and all of y'all come to me, right? The heads. So, Satan understands this, so he will work on the emotions of women to try to turn their husbands unknowingly, most times, sometimes knowingly, away from the ways of God because of how something feels. This is so good. And what Satan does is work on the emotion and the feeling of a thing, listen to me, rather than the principled perspective of guidance of God's word. And we can get away from emotional Christianity and live principled Christianity, we will have the authority to put the devil in his place. Let me do it again. Spirituality, who and what we worship. Morality, what is righteous and what is evil and wickedness. And then what you spend your money on. For the life of me, it just bothers me how you can pay for a cell phone, but your teenager can go to everything under the sun, underneath the phone, and spend your money on it, and you don't check the phone. And then wonder why hell has broke out in your house. I saw one commercial, or reel one time, when the dad, I love this one, the dad, the boy had bad grades in school, and so the boy kept slamming the door in the house. So the father went upstairs and was working on the door, inside the door jumps, and was taking the, and took the door off of the door hinges. And walked away. And walked away with the door right in his hand. It was like, I'm going to just keep this so until you start respecting the house and respecting your mom.
Right?
Right? This is why it's important. A lot of times we're in a society because of fatherlessness. Let me just speak to that. I know you didn't ask me that, but let me just speak to that. Sometimes many men have never been trained and never had a good model. So they just do what society tells them rather than what the scripture tells them. Yeah. If you want a household that is, that God is the head, Corinthians is very clear. It is God, it is the man, husband, it is the wife, and then the children. That's God's order to keep anarchy out. When I got crazy, all male children try their fathers. I said, okay? Me and my happy preacher kid self, too. Only had one time to try my dad. He is almost 80. I still don't try him. And he's almost 80. Does that help? Does that answer?
Amen. Is that good? Yes, sir.
Come on, give a little praise right now.
Right,
we got more questions. We got more cards. We can quit. All right. I think that is good too. All right. If you got more questions, more cards, send them this way. Any more questions, comments, concerns, thoughts, opinions? Go ahead, Erica. Let me come to you, Mother. Mother, I know your question is going to be a humdinger, so yours is going to be last. Okay, it's gonna be last. Go ahead, Ms. Thomas.
So, I understand what you're saying about, but doesn't as a woman,
I know where you're going. Just ask it out straight.
I'm not gonna be too submissive to a man that's not submissive to God.
Yes. Ask the question, Ms. Cox. Come on.
So, how do you not then, as a woman, put yourself in a position you're not supposed to be in if a man's not doing what he's supposed to do?
Okay. So, I'm going to answer that one in layers. While you are a single woman, watch patterns more than performance. Watch patterns more than performance. How does he handle conflict, I said? How does he handle conflict in regards to when he is angry? How does he handle conflict in his work environment? Is he submitted to the authority structures in his life, on the job, civil society? How well does he have relationship with the authority structures of his life, his own parents and extended family? What do they have to say about him? Let me say it again. Follow and study patterns and not his performance.
Right.
Yeah, he got a big chest and big shoulders and big muscles and all of that. Let me just, I'm so glad she's not here today, but I still got to watch myself because I'm on camera. Everybody understand what I mean when I say performance?
That's right.
Some of y'all lose it because the performance is so good when you should not have been in the performance mode anyway.
Yes, say so, sir.
I'm just talking real to you today.
Go ahead, Bishop.
So you have to watch patterns, and if patterns live by principle, so that's number one as a single woman. Mm-hmm. Let me come to the court women, to the women who are courting. You've been courting for a while. Same thing applies. Then guess what? She's not married. And if you see enough red flags, run, Forrest, run! Okay? Lord, I'm trying to. If I give Lady this microphone, it's going to be a whole thing. Because here's the thing. There was a period of time, I'm trying to remember what year it was when Paul came up here, and Paul made me go back to him. We probably was going to break up that weekend because she was tired of me. She was real tired of me. And she was like, I know you hurt. I know you frustrated. I know you mad. I know you upset. But at some point, bruh, She won't talk to me like bishop and reverend. I was the man she was dating and courting. She's like, bruh. Come on, just say it with me, bruh, bruh, bruh. Right? What now here's watch the balance. Another man that was assigned to me took one look at me and was like, you not preaching this Sunday. Get your hips down here to North Carolina again. Now, as a man that carries authority, if I don't understand how to submit myself under authority, I feel the Holy Ghost. If a man cannot submit himself under authority, run.
That's right.
Because you're not the head honcho of everything all the time.
That's right.
You got to have somebody in your life that can chin check you. Let me get up on the camera. Bro, you need somebody who can get in your Kool-Aid and ain't afraid of you.
That's right.
That does not mind telling you the truth to your face. So, you have to be able to have that too, okay? Now, let me come to the third level, married women. Women that are, here is the common mistake most married women do. They try to tell him about himself and about what he's done wrong, what he ain't got right, what he ain't doing, what's not happening, what's not taking place, and how he should do this, that, and so. Let me, as a man's man, tell you what men hear when you do that. Wah, 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 wah. We're not listening to a word that you say. Ooh, I feel the Holy Ghost. I'm getting ready to shout now. What you must learn to do, just like you do with your children, I didn't get you to God a long time ago. You must
Amen.
Learn to close your mouth.
Uh-huh.
Yes. Can I say it one more time?
Yes.
You must learn to close your mouth and go to your heavenly Father.
That's right.
I hate to even, I got to just do it this way. Give me three men real quick. Three men, come on, give me three. I need three brothers real fast. If you're questioning your man or not, that moment, that's an issue. Thank you. I need three of y'all real quick. Real quick. All right, I got the three. Oh, y'all gonna let Keith get in too. Keith, you ain't taking that. You're not gonna take mine. Praise Jesus. I'm still young. Keith was one of the first ladies I dedicated to Mr. Park. Keith, you up front. And then we're gonna put Gray in the back. And then, Keith, come on over to the front. Look, what you mentioned? 330? 275? God, dog. Hit me, yeah, I remember that too. This is serious linebacker on my hand. He's the real thing. I'm trying to tell you, bro. Okay, so what happens is, ladies, you must learn to do this right here, okay? This is God back here. This is your husband in the middle. This is you. I'm glad this worked out this way. Because this is, the way that he is built is some of y'all's mouth. This is your mouth right here. Just muscles everywhere. Say everything you think of, just flip it out the mouth any old kind of way. This is you. You know I'm right.
That's good right there.
So what you must learn to do is to tone it down, and most of you turn and do this. Yeah, this is what you do. This is you right here. This is you, right? And he's like, I'm just trying to help, right? You must learn how to stop flexing, and you must learn to do this. And you must learn to talk to God.
That's right.
And if the scripture is right, I guess you'd say, yeah, thank you, Holy Spirit. The scripture is right. God will then talk to your husband.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. If you talk to your husband, if you come back and stay in place like you're supposed to, God will talk to your husband and he will change. Now, here is the thing with most of us. The change may not happen as soon as you would like for it to be.
Uh-huh.
Now, you've got to have a work of patience working in you. Let patience have its perfect work that you may lack nothing. Because God is working on you in the area of the mouth and self-control, and God is working on him on obedience and humility. All that's happening at the same time.
That's right.
And when he gets to a place, ooh, I feel it right through here. When he gets to a place where he's tired, or let's just pick an issue, he's tired of the lights being cut out and the water being cut off and this not happening and that not taking place and this ain't working and that ain't working. And he go to God, ooh, ladies, y'all better hear me today. And he turns to God, turns to God and has a conversation with God. And now he's like, Lord, I'm trying to figure out how I can get this thing working. And you know how my voice gets like that? I'm trying to figure out how I can get this thing working. And God is like, shut up. Did you do this? And then all of a sudden, we're like, okay, Lord, I missed that. I just totally missed that. Good. I need you to go do this and do that. And do this and do that. Once this happens, right, he will turn back around. And now his whole posture and conversation with you will be different.
Yes, sir.
Because God will let him know you're not listening to the help I'm giving you. And you keep trying to do stuff yourself on your own. That's why this is like this. See, but you can't get to that place. And you keep flexing, right? So if you get to the place where you stop flexing with the mouth and allow God to speak for you, then you keep, now we're still in alignment. Come together, guys, come together, come. Just stay in line, stay in line, stay in line, stay in line. Well, that's good. Lock arms real quick. Okay. So you're still in alignment. Here comes pedophilia trying to get in your house. Can't get in. Here comes the teenage boy trying to sleep with your 15-year-old daughter. Can't get in. Okay. Here comes a struggle and frustration with gender identity trying to get in your house. Can't get in. Because you maintain alignment. Here comes drug abuse trying to get in your house. Can't get in. Because alignment, right? So what God wants is to keep the house protected so that the children are covered, and that comes by way of order. And if we maintain order, we keep the protection in the house so that everybody is getting what they need. As a matter of fact, I didn't finish it. 1 Peter chapter 3 and all the way to verse 9. If your husband does not respond to you correctly and treat you gently, God does not hear him pray. Now that's the Bible.
That's Bible.
Okay? That's Bible. So if he don't respond to you with gentleness, care, and concern, and do things God's way, I can tell you time and time, I had to do a lot of humble pie and a lot of moments where God was like, okay. Negro, are you in charge or am I? Okay? So you got to get to a place where we're willing, thank you, brothers, where we're willing to do things God's way. Amen, somebody?
Amen.
Does that help somebody right there? So number one, ladies, run from jokers who are not submitted to God.
Right.
If you're cornered, you still got a chance to run.
That's right.
Brothers, focus on listening to obey God in your personal life before you get married and try to have a family.
Right.
Be a disciplined man ahead of time so that you don't have to have God come discipline you inside of a family context. Come on, somebody say, he just right. And then lastly, ladies, just control the tongue, talk to God, let God work on both of you. Amen, somebody? Come on, give the Lord praise right there. That was good today. Come on. Lord have mercy. All right, let me get to the home thing because this is going to be something right here. All right, go ahead, mother. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
We're still talking about relationships. Mm-hmm.
How does the wife sanctify
the husband? I told y'all it was going to be a home. I told y'all. Y'all just need to clap your hands for Mother, because she comes with it every time. So, what the scripture says that the unbelieving spouse can sanctify the believing spouse sanctifies the unbelieving spouse. Mother, you want me to get all weak? Okay, the first area is prayer. Prayer is how you sanctify the spouse that unbelieves or the man that is not listening before the Lord. I need my glasses. Are they okay? Come on, girl. Me and you, we got the same kind of jacked up eyes. Let me see this. I'm trying, because I got to be careful about my commentary. Okay, we all right. Is the baby sleeping? The baby sleeping. Okay. So, prayer is one. So, ladies, there are times where I know she don't like me to tell her stuff all the time, but, you know, she know how to get to God when I'm unconscious. That girl be up 2, 3, 4 in the morning laying on her face, and I can feel the Holy Ghost working on me because that girl be praying. I'm telling y'all, I got a praying wife. That's why I'm saving the day. I'm just telling you. That's true. That's true. Now, I'm trying to just move, Holy Spirit. Okay. You must learn how to use your femininity in a sanctified way so that God is able. Let's back up. Use your femininity in a sanctified way. So that God is enabled to envelop you so that every time he experiences you, he's experiencing himself in God. Amen. That's the best way to say that. Go back and listen to me say that again and play it over and over again. Now, let me give you Bible for what I just said. When Israel was in bondage under the hand of the Persian leader, Xerxes. Artaxerxes in the scripture. The one that Vashti ran away from, right? Because of his rude and crude behavior. What ends up happening is that for an entire year, Esther and the other virgins prepared themselves to meet the king. As they prepared themselves to meet the king, they went through detoxification. They literally were washed and bathed and detoxified in terms of their internal makeup and personhood. And so, after about a year of that work of purity, what ends up happening on that one night, remember Mordecai comes to Esther and says, who knows that maybe you may have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. Remember Esther's words? If I perish, I perish, but I'm going in to see the king. That's a whole message right there by itself. So she takes time to become purified internally so that when the king experiences her, that girl can get anything she wants from the king. Y'all better hear what I'm saying to you. Because the question is, how do you sanctify your husband? You get sanctified and pure yourself as a woman, and you utilize your femininity so that he is experiencing a purity between him and you and God. And I'm trying to just be delicate with this so that God can talk to him and God can utilize that. Y'all think that it doesn't happen, but I'm giving you Bible. When Esther sits in front of Xerxes and she's downcast, remember the scripture. The scripture says that he asked her, what's wrong? And Esther said, well, my people are in bondage. And my people need to be free. And there's a plan that's been set to destroy all of my people. Well, it's just the night before. Y'all got it? Okay. And so Xerxes says, look here. Haman, bring me my signet ring, writes the law, writes the decree, seals that bad boy, sets all of them free, all because she went through detoxification. Ladies, if you will detoxify yourself in terms of the culture of this world, become a woman of purity, of beauty by the Spirit first. I'm going to be in 1 Peter now. Become a woman of purity by the Spirit. It is not so much the outer beauty as it is the internal beauty. If you get the internal beauty together, so that when you speak, God is talking through the delicacy of your mouth. What happens is that gets a man's attention, and all of a sudden he can start to hear God again in terms of what the Lord is saying to him. But in our culture, in our time, we got too many, I don't even know what BBL stands for. I don't even know what it is. But we got all of that and brash and loud and rude and crude and just all of that all over the place. No. You want to sanctify your husband. You become sanctified yourself and then live a lifestyle of consecration before the Lord. Now, let me add this, mother, just because I'm right here. That does not absolve men from consecrating themselves. Men must consecrate themselves before the Lord also. As a matter of fact, brothers, the way that the scripture is written, we are the first ones to consecrate themselves before God. We walk upright before the Lord and holy before the Lord first, so that we don't need her to consecrate us. We should be consecrating her. Come on, say amen.
Quiet.
But in case it is the reverse, then it's your lifestyle of prayer, it's your inward beauty of focus, and then you got to turn into a warrior lady at the same time. Come on, stand on your feet because we're going home after this one, because I don't want to have a whole other hour service at church. You got to know how to work that word. You got to know how to work that word as a woman. When ain't nobody else there, you got to get that Bible and get that word out and walk through your house and declare that word all over your house. See, sister girl over here thinks she's slick. She's not slick.
Good,
this girl will put the Ten Commandments up in the living room, put some other commandments up in the family room, got some other scriptures up in the kitchen, got another one up by the door when you first come in the house. When you walk in the house, you walk around, it's just word everywhere, word everywhere. You got to know how to be able to work that word so the word start working for you.
That's
as
right.
A woman in your house. Come on, say amen at the end. Come on, give the Lord a praise. Come on, Sheila. Yes.
Talk about your engagement, courtships, and things that we should be doing a lot more as it relates to engagements and things that are.
Yes. It's a character flaw. Mm-hmm. Okay, and you, then you have to decide what character flaw you're going to live with.
That's right.
Get in trouble.
Say that, Bishop. Say that.
When you get older, you are less likely to tolerate stuff in your 40s, 50s, and 60s than you did in your 20s and your 30s.
That's right.
Which is to say, and I'm going to really, I'm going to just look at the screen when I say this. People ain't got but one time. When you in your 40s, 50s, 60s, they ain't got but one time to try. Come on, y'all understand what I'm saying? You got to learn how to put that in, Erica, don't laugh at me like that. You got to learn how to put that in to your repertoire, because then you want to isolate and get riffraff out and away from you quickly.
That's right.
I think that what we should do is maybe through the rest of the summer on last Sundays, let's just talk, you and I, about red flags.
Okay?
I think Lady and I will do that together about red flags. I'm going to close the service and I'm going to drop this microphone and run when I say this. Because that girl was trying to run from me like the plague. She was trying to run from me. She was like, dude, you got one. You ain't got one time. You got half the time. Right? And if a man really loves you, he will tighten up quick. Okay, brothers. One time. If she really love you, she will tighten up quick. Okay? Amen, somebody?
Amen.
Come on, let's give the Lord praise right now. Come on, God, I know you imagine that. You imagine all that. Come on, we pray. This is good in here on today. We'll do that throughout the summer. Is that all right, somebody?
Yes.
Amen.
Well, let me just say this tonight. We're singles, you are not desperate.
That's right.
It's altered when you're desperate. You are the light of the land.
That's
when
right.
You're desperate.
That's
and
right.
So because of that, your decisions are going to be different. And I'm going to leave it right there so we can talk about it a little. Let's pray.
Amen.
Father, we just thank you today for all that has gone on. Lord, we just are just in awe of you. Lord, we thank you for opening up areas of opportunity where we can hear from you and hear from heaven. God, we just thank you right now for a purified flow that's coming from the throne room of God.
Yes.
So that, Lord, we know how to operate in daily life.
Yes.
God, you have not left one stone unturned. And so for that, we say thank you. God, as
thank you, Lord.
In summer sessions, God, we pray that we are not in heat looking for answers outside of you, but that, God, we are content with you. That, Father, we find our answer in you.
Yes.
And God, we thank you right now that you're securing us. God, you said godliness with contentment is great gain.
Yeah.
So God, I pray a spirit of contentment, oh God. And then, Lord, that you would cause us to understand and recognize the value of who we are in
yes.
you. And that, God, you made us, God, not only unique and special, but God, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. God, we're not going to give ourselves just to anybody. But Lord, we're thanking you right now for ordained and covenant relationships
yes.
and friendships
yes.
in Jesus' name.
Yes.
And God, we give you praise. Now, God, I pray for each and every one under the sound of our voices. Lord God, that you would bless them and keep them this week. That Lord, you keep a hedge of protection all about them,
yes.
all around their finances, all around their homes, all around their children, everything that concerns them. God, I pray that it's under the blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for that hedge of protection. We give you praise for it right now.
Hallelujah.
And Lord God, we leave here with a praise and with a worship.
Yes.
God,
yes.
just as we entered in with a praise and a worship, we leave
yes,
here
Lord.
With a praise and a worship.
Yes,
giving
Lord.
You all the glory, giving you all
yes.
the honor, giving you all the praise. It's in
yes.
Jesus' name that we pray. Bless your people, oh God. Keep us until we meet again. In Jesus' name, amen.